We are Sidra and Scott Morris. We're really excited to talk about some things we have learned about education, and in the hopes of supporting people who are interested in education, interested in finding something for their children, and tips and tricks, and just support. We started a school, a private school, about 5 years ago. And so some of our stories are not just from our own family, but they're from also from all of the kids that we have seen go through our private school. Hope that you can find it interesting.
And the first topic that we thought about talking about was a question that keeps coming to us over and over again. What do I do if my kid's behind? They're not on level. They are not learning anything.
Do you want to get us started?
Yeah, so we think this actually comes from the public system, which is actually trying to save itself. And we know in many ways that the public school system is failing. It's failing our kids quite drastically in some areas. And so we know that when a kid is behind, they're being told they're behind because there needs to be a very clear levelization up so that so that the public system can actually mark where they're at.
And measure
where they're at.
And, you know, give statistics to the powers that be that give them money.
Yeah, and when we keep telling kids that they are not at the right level and we keep putting pressure on them and we give them grades and things like that, then what ends up happening is the student starts to feel like they actually are, so like something's wrong with them because they're not at the right level at the right time.
Yeah.
And that can be quite damaging, I think, to the
isolating.
Spirit.
I think I just remember just even growing up, those kids that were pulled out, and I think everybody knows about those kids that were pulled out of the classroom, and it has long-term damage. Like, it's just hard. It's hard because they start to feel dumb. They start to feel like something's wrong with them. They're not, they're not obedient. They're not, what am I doing? What am I doing wrong? And there's just a lot of developmental things that that are difficult for the kids when that happens.
So let's actually speak about development.
Mm-hmm.
We know that each kid, all of us kind of progress at a different rate. Sidra likes to use the example of walking, and physically, some of us just don't walk very, very quickly.
Yeah,
sometimes it takes us, 2 years or something like that instead of a year.
Yeah.
And most doctors say, well, it's just they learn when they learn, and we kind of accept that.
And maybe they need just a little bit more support if they're slow walkers, but really when it comes to by five, no one's asking what age did your child walk, but as a mother, having friends or whoever at around the same age, it's the same feeling of, well, my child walked at 9 months, but mine didn't until 14. And so, but really that's just brain development, and it's the same with our brain as we get older. It just develops at different paces, but in the end, as long as they're in a good, rich environment, those connections are made. And like the slow walker, with a little bit of support and a good, encouraging environment, they get there. And yeah, same with reading at 20. Who's gonna ask, what age did you learn at 3 or did you learn at 8? Which brings us to another story. So we have a couple of examples for this. Our own daughter, she was a slower talker when she was younger. And language is just not huge. She's very much stronger on her mathematical logic side of her brain. That's just a snap for her. But language just was always just a little bit slower. And so she's actually 8 right now, and for the last couple of years, we've just been encouraging. Our house is full of books. She has older siblings who are reading, so she's just in a rich environment. We go to the library, we point out letters, and I've done little steps with her here and there, but I never pushed her, and also she wasn't in an environment of comparison to peers, so she never felt like something was wrong with her. this year.
She just hated reading.
She just didn't like it. She hated
she
it.
Just, well, she didn't necessarily hate it, but she just didn't
know,
see the
she,
purpose.
All of my kids loved for me to sit down and snuggle with them and read them books every day, but she never did. She never liked me to read to her.
Yeah.
So I would just kind of sneak in literacy whenever I could, you know. And when she felt like, and as soon as she was like, nah, I'm done, I wouldn't push it. You know, I might push it just a little bit, but stop, you know. Just try and encourage a little bit past comfort levels, but then never go too far, which is another big thing, is it's more important to have that good relationship with your child is
Absolutely.
Another big one. So I never pushed her where it would damage our relationship or it would damage her feelings or make her feel like something was wrong. I know we had some like frustration, moments for both her and I. But then this year, just something happened. The time was right. Her brain developed enough, or she saw something and something just, and everybody hasn't seen this with their kids. As a teacher, you see this with kids all the time, just that aha click on moment where it's like, and suddenly she just wants to read. And suddenly she's starting to, you know, go from those little readers to she's older, so she wants a chapter book. So we find little tricks of helping her feel like she's not reading a baby book. She's reading an older book, but at her level. And suddenly that's helping her along the process where she is slowly eking her way through chapter books. A month or two later, and now she's reading to her little brother chapter books, and she is on grade level now. And it all happened in the span of about 6 or 7 months, and she's fine, and she's happy, and she loves it. And when she's bored, she'll pick up a book and read to her little brother because she feels awesome because she can read and he can't, and so she feels awesome. And you know, again, when she's 20. No one's going to ask, did you learn to read when you're 3 or did you learn to read when you're 8? This brings up a very, very another very important point. So one is, you know, making sure that they don't ever feel like they can't do it. And that's often, I think, what happens in the environment where they're taken out or they need extra help, is there's just something with the brain development that... starts to make them feel like they can't do it, or they, and so that you start to hear things like, I hate math, and or I can't read, or I'm dumb, and there is something in their brain that kind of shuts off, and they start to believe some of those messages because they're pulled aside, because they're just not on the exact level as they're in a competitive environment as their peers. There's also positive environments where they don't feel that competition. But in an environment where it is, they're supposed to be exactly the same level and it's a competitive environment, then they start to feel like, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I hate reading, I hate math. Does that sound familiar? And that's when it starts to be really hard and difficult. And so the goal is always, you know, that's kind of the damage that happens in those environments. And so the goal should always be, you know what, their emotions first, they will get there. And so as if you're at home teaching your kids either after school or you're a home educator, a homeschooler, that should always be the goal, is one, don't damage your own relationship with your child, but two, just keep encouraging, keep bringing a good environment, keep loving them, and that it will happen. It will happen. And you do just what you do as a parent. You notice the signs, you notice their readiness, and you just in a loving way just keep encouraging them. Now, if they have already started to say, I'm dumb, or I'm not good at this, then, you know, there's some tricks and tips for that as well to help them heal, and then they can start to progress again.
When we talk about learning and what time do we learn, what age do we learn a particular thing, we used to be really accepting of learning things at different ages. My oldest children and I are reading The Adventures of Huck Finn right now. And Huck is, they think he was probably between the ages of 12 and 14. And he didn't know how to read. And he was taken in by a widow, and the widow forced him to go to school, and he learned how to read, and he didn't want to learn how to read, and he didn't think it was necessary, and he had all this learning about the river and how important the river was, and he had all this knowledge, but he just didn't think that reading was all that important. And it's funny because you learn later that Huck Finn was, he learned how to read, and then he started teaching others about history and about science and all these things that he had read. And I think it's just showing that Mark Twain was, lived in a time period in the late 1800s that where it was much more accepting to just learn at a different age, yeah. Right? If it wasn't at 8, well then it would come at 12 or 14 or something like that.
And if your child feels that from you, where it's like, oh, it's no big deal, then it's no big deal to them. Even if they're in a situation where someone, because we've had this example with that same daughter where she was supposed to read something and she couldn't. And an adult just kind of made her feel small for not being able to read. Then she comes home and she showered with other people that we have surrounded her with who were like, it's fine. And she has so many other skills and she'll get there. And we're not worried about whether or not she'll get there. We had an amazing mentor when we were first kind of going down this what learning can be journey, who told us that her son didn't learn until 11 or 12. And finally it was like making weapons or something that finally got him interested in reading.
Sword building.
It was like sword building, and he finally he wanted to read about it, and so he learned. He
read everything.
And then he's been in. Then he went to college. So, he's fine. It was 11, but that was 11 or 12, and we live in a very literate society. For one, you have a great environment. They're gonna learn how to read. They're gonna learn math. We're surrounded by we're at a very high, for the most part, education level around us, right? The biggest damage that comes from literacy and from math is actually when those children feel like there's something wrong with them and they shut it off. That's where we, I think, have problems in our environment. Is if they feel that then they shut down, that's where we have problems with kids struggling with literacy, and that's where we have problems with kids struggling with math. Our biggest message is you can do it. You're their parent. You are the most qualified to help them and to help them through it.
I take confidence that you are their best mentor and that you will inspire them.
All right, till next time.
We'll see you later.